So if I could just ask you, I'm going to come very, very briefly into this and move away. This is Babette Babich, and this is Father Bill Richardson, and we are here at Boston College in St. Mary's for a conference of various kinds, but also to have what we're hoping is a good discussion right now about Heidegger and being and time. I have asked very spontaneously, so Bill's not prepared for this, but I have asked spontaneously if there might be a possibility of just in a general way saying what element stays with you most about being and time. And that's an odd question, because it's such a well-known book, and if anybody knows it, it would be you. And so at this point, what, when you look at it as an achievement, as a book as a whole, are there elements of it, passages of it, qualities of it, what stands out to you? Not what should stand out, but what stands out to you?
Well, that's a big question, obviously. And to do it justice, it would take a big answer. But what has struck me about it is what was not in being and time. But I mean, it was as a book and as a work, even though unfinished and in that sense limited, though it is and remains, it was the articulation of something previous. And what remains with me and grows with time, not to say the years, is that initial experience that gave birth to being in time. And that was made clear to me when, having finished most of my own work, on, at least on being in time, I had the opportunity of meeting Heidegger. And it was in that meeting that I asked him if it was true what had been told me in the scuttlebutt of graduate students, namely that being in time really didn't come first of all from Husserl or Kierkegaard, but basically came from Aristotle, and that the initial experience was basically Heidegger's experience with Aristotle. And so when I met him, and was given the chance to pose some personal questions to him, that was the question that I posed. It's been rumored that Aristotle had a major role in being in time, and I'm wondering if that's true. Can one say that? And his answer was, in effect, took the form of a letter that he wrote as preface to the book itself, that when he was himself a student, namely 19 years old, and therefore on the last edge of his gymnasium experience, therefore would be, in one sense, our high school, but in their sense really would be about sophomore, junior year in college. So he was a mature 19, certainly intellectually mature. And someone whose name was Gruber, who eventually became the Archbishop of Freiburg when Heidegger became rector of the university, of unhappy experience. But Gruber was a parish priest in Constance at the time, where Heidegger was finishing up his gymnasium, as we call it, they call it. And this book happened to be the doctoral dissertation of Brentano, which carried the name of the meaning of being in Aristotle, or the manifold meaning of being in Aristotle, where being there meant Aristotle's, the meaning of being in Aristotle for Brentano, where being there meant Aristotle's un, namely that which is. So that the whole dissertation was based upon the different senses that on, namely that which is, has in Aristotle. And they are numerous. But concretely, what that suggests to me, it's the experience of different meanings that is has in our own daily life. Namely, this is a camera, this is reception room, and this is the seventh day of October, and this is a chair, and this is a person who's talking to you, who is for me a person. So the is has many different meanings, you know, because each of these things, including ourselves, is differently. That's what makes us different, that makes it possible for us to be different. But nonetheless, there is some common denominator, to put it crudely, in that word is. And Heidegger's question was precisely that. What about this is? It's common to all these things that are, and even for Aristotle and Brentano and all the rest of the world, what is the common denominator of that is? So his question was precisely that. What is the is that pervades and comes to expression in everything that is? And what's the difference between this is that is shared and the is that is not shared? But because it is in every case. So that was his initial question. And for a 19-year-old, that's a serious question. And he went to all the sources at his disposal, and that question remained, because whomever he read, whether Aristotle himself, or Plato, or Plotinus, or the pre-Socratics, no matter whom he read, each of them used the word is in one form or another, but none of them posed the question about what is the is of these different forms of is. I think of it as the capital is of what is, where what is not simply what is a being or a thing, but what is the case, which is a formula which is common now to describe something that is, but it's not a thing like other things, but nonetheless is. So I think of the question of Heidegger as he described it to me, viva voce, so to speak, sitting in front of his office. He said that's what really inspired him, you know? And he found no answer to that question. So it fundamentally is his fundamental question that began there and persevered, as far as we know, at least as far as I know, to the day he died, was precisely that. What is the capital is of what is the case? So that was his question. And eventually he told me that not only did he experience in that initial epiphany, if you want to call it that, was the fact that no one else posed the question, even though these were the giants of our history, namely Plato, Aristotle, Plotinus, and the rest. Every Greek author that he could get his hands on at that time. So what struck him not only was the fact that it's a question worth posing, what is the capital is of everything that is, including what is the case? And so the fact that they did not raise the question, although it was so obvious, that suggested to him that whatever the answer is, there is buried inside that answer something that accounts for the fact that it negates the very exploration of itself. And therefore that this negation that's ingredient to the experience of the question about the capital is what is, and what, including what is the case, is part of the original experience. So along with the question about being, as it's now called, you know, the question itself includes a negative component That is to say, there's something in this capital is, however we understand it, that includes somehow a negation of itself, or a limitation of itself, in any case, a not, a nicht. So that this nicht ingredient to the question itself that somehow sabotages it from the very beginning is ingredient to it. And therefore, the question for Heidegger was simply not so much what does this capital is of everything it is mean, but also what is it that includes this negative component, this ingredient nicht, that includes a negation of the question, even in opposing the question itself. So if you ask me what's most striking about being in time, is the fact that in retrospect, you know, as I work through it and as you work through it and continue to work through it and teaching it again, the importance of that nicht element, which is, comes down to an element of finitude in the question itself. It includes its own not and therefore its own limit. That is the question of being, and in going through being time in retrospect, it becomes clearer to me that being in time is an articulation of that question, beginning with Dasein as being in the world, and also that negation of the question, because not only is the question, but being itself as understood, whether its being shows up as the world to which we're open or some other thing. That is the question that bothers Heidegger. And that is the question about the Sinn, as he calls it at the time, the meaning of being, where being is understood as the capital is of what is, no matter what it's called in the tradition. Anyway, that's all I can say about what being in time means to me.
Thank you very much. If you can answer one other question for us.
Sure.
Your work foregrounds in your engagement with Heidegger, and sometimes I think arguably also in Lacan, your reading of Lacan, foregrounds errancy. And that's a word which a lot of people associate with you, but I don't think everybody knows a lot about what that means. This is the very idea. It's a complicated word in German. It's sure. Just as complicated in English, and English is great because it's very related to German with this word. So your choice of translation is elegant because it capitalizes on the affinity between English and German in this one sense. It's not always true. I think it's true in this case.
Yeah.
But could you say one, because this is something that people always ask me about, and I do my best, but I think it would be great if we heard it from you.
If I do my best, then I'm equally unsatisfied.
we'll do what we can.
I'll try. This notion of errancy is ingredient to the notion of truth in Heidegger. And to move from where we were a moment ago in this is question, I'm obviously taking being to be this capital is, you know, whatever it's called in Greek, einai or ousia or whatever. But one other thing that he added in his explanation to me at that time, and comes up again in this letter, it says serves as preface, that along with that insight into the question, there was an insight into the method of going about it, namely phenomenology as a method, for reasons that you can explain and would take us away from the question that you're asking. But phenomenology was to lay out in the open the beings around us that are phenomena. And the only method that was alive at the time, intellectually alive, was the notion of phenomena as proposed by Husserl, who had developed a way of approaching beings under the guise of phenomena, that which appears. So that for him the being question, for Husserl the being question, it became what is the meaning of these phenomena? And for Husserl, the meaning of the phenomena is what that they appear to be under the stricture of his own optics, so to speak, namely as a former mathematician and arithmetician, saw that the model for certainty or clarity about philosophical issues, such as the question about being, was really mathematics. Because, and the reason why it was a model was that mathematical analysis, particularly arithmetic, but it's true of any form of higher mathematics, both the content of the material, the classics, the medievalists used to say the material object of their reflection. You know, as to say, the matter that they could deal with was a matter that was already very abstract insofar as in their minds. You know, if they were talking about the properties of a triangle, it was a triangle that was idealized, if that's the word, but in any sense, proposed in an abstract order from any real triangles we expect, and therefore with a purity that is possible for an arithmetician to deal with the relationship between numbers or the relationships that constitute trigonometry, whatever it constitutes the basis of that tripod. Anyway, point is that for Husserl, the real meaning of what a being is really, it takes mathematics as the model, where for mathematics, the material you're examining and the instrument with which you're examining are both interior to consciousness. You know? And it's understandable for Husserl. You know? And that was his sense of a philosophy as a rigorous science, you know? Namely to try and find that same clarity of perception and correspondence between the material that you were judging and the method by which you're examining it could be verified simply because they verify themselves, you know? And with the clarity that's possible for a mind working in that order. Obviously, he did not mean that philosophy can be reduced to some kind of mathematical formula where you can find that same correspondence between mind and object being examined, and also a function of mind. But it was an ideal for him. And what he tried to do in order to be able to take the phenomena of experience, what he tried to do is to lead that back from normal social experience, such as we're having now, back to a point where one could sort of prescind from the facts, you know, like the fact of that tripod, and just contemplate the notion of a triangular instrument in itself, and strip it from the contingencies of the social order, you know, the natural order, the natural way of being, namely the way that tripod yields to the contingencies of its composition, etc. What Husserl called a reduction was to reduce experiences of common social life back to a level where he could examine just the idea of what a tripod is, or the idea of what it is to perceive a flower out here. What is perception and so as such? And therefore, having made that reduction, Husserl could go ahead with his work. And the result of this work, would be to try and discover the real meaning of perception, the real meaning, and therefore what, let's say, a tripod be a tripod. And therefore, if you could get to that clarity, having made this reduction and got an insight into this reduced, so to speak, as they reduced the level of conscious knowing, that would yield you, tell you what the being of this object is, and therefore it was easy to transpose the notion of being, for Husserl, to that which is discovered through phenomenology, which now he, that which is discovered, he called it an eidos, a Greek word, which is clear enough, but I say it's traditional enough. And as soon as, and sometimes translated as ideas, certainly, but an eidos for Husserl meant more than that, you at that which makes a thing to be what it is. You got at the essence of something. This is the ideal. And therefore, for him, for Husserl, there is a correspondence between the ideal object, the ideal object of phenomenology was to discern the being of the objects that he disclosed. So the being really meant an object of consciousness. You know? And with all that that implies and all the difficulties that are involved in doing it. Anyway, what was his criterion of truth, really, for deciding whether you really got into the eidos, the essence of the things that he was analyzing? The evidence itself, you know, the evidence, evidence is evidence, you know, and the evidence for truth is the evidence that it presents in its own name. Well, now, Heidegger grew up in that mentality, so that what he said, what his method was going to be phenomenology, in the sense that he was going to try and decide this zin, the meaning of this is in everything that is, by trying to do the same thing. Except that the difference was that he didn't want to do that simply in terms of reducing or drawing the object of examination back into consciousness. He wanted to examine it in its matter-of-factness. So that became the ideal of Heidegger in the phenomenological method. But in doing so, he was stuck with the notion that being is essentially something that can be related to consciousness, or no, not consciousness, but to human presence, you know, that he called Dasein, that first of all. And secondly, he was deeply struck by this notion of evidence, as it's called in Husserl, but for Heidegger, the word that stuck with him was not so much evidence as truth. So that for, and he mentions that in his letter, this is one of the first things that struck him, that truth is not some kind of statement that we make that's conformed to the things as we experience, some kind of conformity. But essentially, truth is something that precedes that and makes that possible. Namely, the shining forth or the evidence, you know, of what appears in such fashion that one can make judgments about it. So it's sort of a pre-judgmental depth of the phenomenon that Heidegger called not so much evidence, although that was essentially the meaning of evidence, but the what he called truth. Where truth he called, after the Greeks, aletheia. He found that word in Aristotle, found it in Aristotle's metaphysics, the word aletheia, where aletheia meant literally, for the Greeks, what it meant for a thing to be unveiled. That is to say, the lethe of the word is what is hidden in some way. And therefore, the what a lethe, that is to say, the prefix a, which is a negative form in Greek, is a privation of hiddenness. So that for Heidegger, from the very beginning, the notion of truth as something more than simply conformity in one's judgment, but rather it meant something that is revealed out of hiddenness, as you say, and unconcealment was sort of fundamental, or concealing was the process by reason of which truth emerges. So that cognate with that early experience of the question about capital is, was the fact that the best way to find out what is this capitalism means is to use phenomenology to examine precisely the phenomena, namely human beings who use it, you know, what they understand by it. So that his early steps were to try and find a way to examine phenomenologically, as best one can, the very phenomena, namely the human being, that poses the question, both in its positivity, as to what actually does it mean for something to be able to be entitled to be the word is about itself, and secondly, somehow the negative component. And therefore, for him, simultaneously, the question about being involved, the question about truth. Now, he deals with truth and being in time, and we've all had the difficulty, or the pleasure at least, of following that particular analysis. But what strikes me, in retrospect, is the importance of that notion of a two-faced is, disclosure and negation, involves not simply the question about the meaning of capital is, but also the meaning of phenomenology and the meaning of the world of phenomena that we're dealing with, beginning with human being itself. So that the analysis of being in time becomes an analysis really of human being that he calls Dasein, and the relationship or the role the truth plays in that process that begins at least in being in time. So that after being in time, so that's your question about you, but. But in 1930, now being in time obviously was published in 1927, but he was unsatisfied obviously with the results of his work. But by 1930 he began to give publicly a lecture that became on the essence of truth. And in that lecture on the essence of truth, he comes to a point of saying of two things, as I perceive it, you know, that after knocking his head against this particular wall in 1927, he still wasn't satisfied with an answer, and somehow, but this is my fantasy, he went to experience, if you keep knocking your head against the wall, soon enough you get the impression that the wall is knocking itself against you. So, however it happened, there, whether it might have been that if you're going to talk about truth as a late day, as unconcealment, well, where does the concealment come from? It must precede the unconcealed, etc. That is a way of struggling with it. And in any case, by 1930, he had gotten to a point of raising the possibility, suppose it is not we who are projecting, let's say, disclosing the is as truth. What if it were is now as a process of concealment and revealment, revealing itself to us? What then? And it's at that, what if that happens, you know, and that's a big move, obviously. Just let's make believe, you know, if anyway, as an experiment. He began to explore that. And I think in number 6 of the essay on the essence of truth, he comes to a point of saying that this process of unconcealment implies that it derives from something earlier than the experience is. You know? And it's that notion of the earlier dimension of being that allows him to think of Aletheia as somehow revealing itself to us. And it's at that point that, as you know, my own thinking, and I think with some warrant, you know, recognized the first move into another emphasis, at least, of this problem, where being is not simply what is disclosed by the analysis of Dasein and the initial conditions of its possibility, but his focus then became on the possibility that truth as Aletheia was somehow revealing itself to us, then we projected, at least the emphasis of the research assumed that focus, it seems to me, at the beginning of 1930 at least. You know. So it's at that point where he begins to explain to explore both the positive aspect of revealment, but he said that there's also a negative component, and that negative component of Aletheia includes, on the one hand, what he calls a hiding of beings behind one another, that he calls geheimnis, which we translate as mystery. But so that this experience of mystery is something that has ontological roots, if that's the right word, or at least philosophical roots in the hiddenness or the lethic, or the negative component of Aletheia. And secondly, there's another form of that negativity which in effect is mysterious to him, because a certain character about that negativity that occludes the revelation of being, as he sabotages it, so to speak, or perverts it somehow. And that so much so that the effect of our endeavor to try and discover what this is means is in effect an experience of a lot of frustration and a lot of failure, of wandering about, for example, wandering about with the question, at the same time having the wandering betrayed, if you will, or, as I said, sabotaged by this negative component that confounds even the experience of mystery. And that's what he calls the irre, I-R-R-E. And the essential thing about it, I think, is the notion of wandering about in confusion, twice confounded. And that confusion, twice confounded, as a movement becomes irren. The irren is the verb describing this wandering about in a confusion that's inevitable, despite best efforts, and really is destructive, well, destructive, but not completely. Sabotaging is the best word, I think. In any case, that's what he means by errancy or irren. It's a secondary component of the negativity ingredient to truth understood as Aletheia. That is for me the mystery still, because if we take it far enough, we get into other questions, as you know. Yeah, I'm talking really to you as representing your students at the moment.
I know. I'm grateful for that. Because it has gotten dark while you were speaking about Lethe.
Okay. And that's the way it happens.
I get a photograph of you also in the darkness.
Okay.
Finding this still. You can't make any kind of video without some images. People do, but it's a mistake. And I'm going to take photographs of the tripod because you talked to me. So. Sorry, I need a flash on that.
Sure.
Boy.
Did we do our duty?
I think so. I think we did more than that, and I'm very grateful. Actually, I've taken more than my half hour. I've taken 36 minutes, so I'm sorry about that. But I appreciate it very much. I think